Hare Krishna, Hare Hare Krishna, dear devotees, please accept my humble obeisances. All glory Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances.
No, you don't do that. You introduce me last. You offer obeisances, you walk them all.
Sorry, Guru Maharaj, your voice is breaking.
Yeah, you learn the protocol. You offer obeisances, you welcome the devotees, you speak about the program, and then you introduce me.
Okay.
And I'm not called Guru Maharaj. I'm just Candramauli Swami.
Okay. Okay. Sure.
Yeah. So all the Zoom hosts have to really know the protocol.
Sure, Maharaj. Sure. I understand. Yeah.
Okay.
So welcome you all to His Holiness Candramauli Maharaj's daily call. And today is, you would have attended Wednesday's call as well. We are discussing Damodarila, as you can see, Yashoda Damodar at the back. In this auspicious month of Kartik, Maharaj is discussing the Yashoda Damodar's Damodar Lila, basically, which is 10th canto, 9th chapter. And we completed the 4th verse last week. Wednesday, and
okay. We need to teach you what to do.
I know, I'm sorry, keep making mistakes. Okay, I share the screen now.
No, I'm not speaking on Dhammara. Today is the disappearance day of Narottama Das Thakura.
Sorry, there is some problem with the voice, Maharaj. Maybe I think we might have to switch off the video because...
Today is the disappearance, the day of Narottama
Das Thakura.
So I'll be speaking on that.
Okay, Maharaj, that's fine. So we'll be speaking, Maharaj, we'll be speaking on Disappearance Day of Narottama Das Thakura today. And there is nothing to share. Do you want to share something?
Disappearance
Day.
Okay. And let's see. Okay, I'll just speak anyway.
Okay.
Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Krishnaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namane Namaste Saraswati Devi Gaudavani Pacharuvanirvase Sunyavani Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So throughout the month of Kartik, there are many appearance and disappearance days. There's also many festivals, such as Krishna Rasayatra, Dipali, or Diwali, also it's called Govardhan Puja. And of course, the disappearance day of the Divine Grace, A.C. Bhakti Vedanta, Swami Srila Prabhupada. So we'll be doing the chapter on Damodar, which is very interesting and full of transcendental meaning. But at the same time, we want to honor such personalities who appeared and disappeared in this month because they are very special. Anyone who appears and disappears in this month obviously has gotten special recognition by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So well, today we'll speak about Srila Narottama Das Thakura. Srila Narottama Das Thakura was a contemporary of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He appeared in a place called Katrigram in what was now known as East Bengal. And he was very much highlighted by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu even before he appeared. And this was very unusual because Mahaprabhu didn't usually do that, talk about persons who were about to appear. But in the case of Narottama, he did. Narottama Das Thakura is known as Mahasaya. He is a supremely great person. He is a very intimate associate of Srimati Radharani in the spiritual world. And he came for many reasons, but one of the main reasons is to revolutionize kirtan. One day, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, along with Lord Nityananda, were walking, and they came to this place in East Bengal where there was one river called the Padma River. And Lord Chaitanya immediately decided to take his bath in the Padma River. And when he did, when he entered into the waters became very rough and started to move around very fast. The personification of the Padma River was very much wondering, what is happening to my waters? And then the Lord spoke to the personification of Padma River, along with Nityananda, was the only other person there. And he said, soon a great personality will appear in this world, and he will come and revolutionize kirtan. And someday he will come and bathe in these rivers. I have left my Krishna prema, my pure love for Krishna, in these waters. And therefore, that's why your waters became rough by the entrance of my Krishna prema. And therefore, he instructed the river, when he comes, please give him this Krishna prema. So Padma listened very carefully and immediately offered her obeisances to the Lord and disappeared. And then the Lord would, when he came out, he was saying, Narottama, 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 Narottama. He had done this before, and everyone was wondering, who is he calling? Who is this Narottama? Because the word Narottama, Nara means man, and Uttamam means the best. The best of all persons. So that is another, that is the word Narottama. Sometimes the word Purushottam also means the best of all Purushas, which are, means those of the human race. And Nityananda inquired from Lord Chaitanya, who is this Narottama you're always coming? He said, soon the great personality will appear. And you know how much I love kirtan, but he will come to revolutionize the whole science of kirtan. And when he does, then kirtan will be taken to another level of ecstasy. And if you're not, become very enlightened with him, Lord Chaitanya. And that was in the year 1534. That was the same year that Lord Chaitanya disappeared. So he made this declaration just a few months before his disappearance. In the following year, 1535, in the area of Katrigram, there was one prince and his wife. They were living, and he was a small landowner, and he was also a king of a province there. And they had a son. And the son was born in the year 1535, which was just almost a year after Lord Chaitanya had disappeared. So So he was a contemporary of Lord Chaitanya, and he never really met Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So now this baby has appeared, and of course, you know, Krishna, his name was Krishna. Can't remember his name, the name of the king or the father of Narottama, his name is Krishna something. And he announced that now a beautiful child has been born. And after some time, 6 months, of course, it's mentioned that after 6 months, the baby should take the first grains. And so a first grain ceremony was organized. And because he was the king, or the ruling head of the area, province, it was a small province in that area, he had many influences. So many people came, according many sages and saintly persons. They came for the ceremony to honor this first grain ceremony by the child of, can't remember the king's name, something Krishna. Anyway, so the ceremony was prepared, and you know the first grain ceremony is very auspicious. It's the first time the child eats grains. And then there is a whole yajna performed with priests and mantras chanting. And then the child, they prepare this type of sweet rice, and then they offer it to the child. So they had prepared the sweet rice, and therefore the father comes and offers the first grains to the baby. Everything was there, everyone was watching. And when the father went to offer the grains, little Narottama, who was just about 6 months old, he immediately turned his head away. He didn't want to eat it. And his father was trying in different ways to put the spoon with the sweet rice in his mouth, but the child wouldn't open his mouth, and he kept turning away from the spoon. And this was considered to be very inauspicious. So everyone was thinking, what is this? The ceremony is not going on. And everyone was thinking, oh, there's some inauspiciousness here. But there was one saint there, kind of a sadhu. He said, no. He doesn't eat food that is not offered to the Lord. So you take it and you offer it to your deity and make it Mahaprasad. So they took the advice of the saintly person and offered it, brought it back. And then when they offered it to Narottama, he immediately took it. So he was only 6 months old, but he would not eat food that was not offered to the deity. So here you could see how special this personality was. So from then on, they only gave him Mahaprasadam, the food offered to the deity. So as he was growing up, he had heard about Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and some of his associates. So some of the sadhus would come because they were very attracted to his little boy. And they would tell him stories about Lord Chaitanya, about Lord Chaitanya's associates, about the pastimes that went on. And he would become overwhelmed with ecstasy, even as a small child, hearing about Lord Chaitanya. And sometimes he would cry out, oh, I'm so unfortunate. The Lord was here and I did not get to see the Lord. And he would just berate himself for being so unfortunate. So this went on for some time. And finally, he developed more and more attachment to Lord Chaitanya and to Lord Chaitanya's associates. And he wanted to go and be with Lord Chaitanya's associates as he started to get a little older. But his parents were very concerned that he was still young and he wanted to leave home. So they arranged for him to be confined so he wouldn't be able to leave. And his father was very diligent. And see, he told his mother, make sure you watch him carefully. Sometimes he would go and get away and some God would bring him back. But one time he convinced his mother somehow or other that he was just going a little ways away and that he would be right back. And then he took the opportunity and left home. When he was traveling, he wanted to go and meet the devotees of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And on his way, he came to the Padma River, that same river where Lord Chaitanya bathed and left his Krishna prem. So Krishna from within his heart inspired him to take bath. So he took bath in the Padma River, and the same thing happened again. Because Lord Chaitanya said to the personification of the Padma River, when she asked the question, how will I know who that person is? And Lord Chaitanya says, when your waters act in the same way as when I entered them, you will know. So as soon as he entered into the river, the river started to become rough, and there were waves, and everything was turbulent. And then, of course, Padma understood. And then Narottama, whose color was somewhat dark, he received Lord Chaitanya's prema, and his whole body turned golden in color, and a beautiful golden color. And that was the indication, just like Lord Chaitanya is Radharani himself, in her internal mood, and he is Gauranga, and she is Gaurangi. And because of that, Lord Chaitanya is the personification of Radharani's God for Lord Krishna. So in the same way, he received that same love coming from Lord Chaitanya through the Padma River. And then he became really ecstatic in love with that. And so after some time, he decided to travel. And then he met up with two other great personalities, Srinivasacharya and Shamananda Pandit. And they became friends and they started to travel together. They were in Vrindavan for a while. And while they were in Vrindavan, they came in contact with Srila Jiva Goswami. And Srila Jiva Goswami was on a mission to spread the glories of the spiritual books that had been written by the Goswamis, such as Rupa Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, Gopal Bhakti Goswami, and other acharyas, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, all of these great persons. No, it wasn't Vishwanath. Vishwanath came later, I'm sorry. Yeah. Sanatana Goswami, Hari Bhakti Vilas, Rupa Goswami, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Udra, and Nilamani, and Gopal Bhakti Goswami's treatise on deity worship. And so there was only one copy of all of these Goswami books, and they were entrusted to Jiva. Jiva was the youngest of all the Goswamis, and many of the Goswamis had already left, so he had the books. Now he wanted the books copied so he could distribute them. Actually, you will read, there was actually books distribution that went on right after that, after they made copies of these books. There are letters between the devotees describing the different incidents on book distribution. The book distribution started way back, even the time when the Goswami was present. So there was a nice plan by Jiva Goswami. And then he talked to Srinivasacharya, Narottama Das Thakura, and Shamananda Pandit. They were traveling together. He said, I want you to take this box of all of these books, one copy of all of the Goswami's works, along with Krishna Das Kapideva Goswami, Chaitanya Charita Kamrup, the resort pack. And I want you to bring them to Navadvip to have them copy. This is the home of the educational institution where they could produce more books. So that was the mission. And Jiva Goswami arranged for a cart pulled by horses and a big box on the cart with all the works of the Goswamis in it and locked up very tightly. And along with 11 guards that he assigned to go to guard the devotees and the books on their travels, because they had to go through dangerous areas. So they were traveling. And they had stopped in this area of one king whose name was Birhambir. Now Birhambir was a king of the province called Vanavishnupur. And he had a policy that he would employ astrologers. And he would ask this astrologer, is there any travelers coming through my kingdom who are carrying any great wealth? And if they told him yes, then he would send his men out to steal the wealth from these travelers. So this king was a real backbite. So he got the word from his astrologers that there's this group of personalities, they're coming and they have a great treasure. So he sent his men out, but he gave instructions, do not harm anyone, but get the treasure. So one night when the devotees were traveling, they had stopped in the evening time to rest. And usually the guards would stay awake, but this particular night, somehow or other, all the guards fell asleep along with the devotees. And the dacoits came and they easily took the box away without even the slightest amount of notice, slightest amount of resistance. And when they woke up, the box was gone. And of course, that sent an alarm into the atmosphere. The books were stolen. What happened? Someone stole the books. The guards fell asleep. It was like something unbelievable, because that was the only copy of these most rare spiritual literatures. And then a voice came in from the sky and said, the king has stolen the books. And only one person heard it. That was Srinivasacharya. So when he heard it, he said to Narottama Das, Narottam, you go on to Khetri Gram and you preach there. And he said to Shamananda, you go to Utkala. Utkala was the former name of the area of Jagannath Puri. And you preach there. And I'll stay here and I'll find the books. They didn't want to leave, but Srinivas was quite adamant and he was somewhat the senior person there. So they accepted it and went on. And then Srinivas decided to stay and find the books. And so he gradually made himself, he traveled, he went to the palace of King Birhambir. And one day there was a discourse on the Srimad Bhagavatam. And many of the pundits, the minutes of this, Birhambir were discussing some of the points in Srimad Bhagavatam. This was a usual affair during those days. Nowadays, we have to arrange that in the schedule. And that's only done by the devotees, but people in general, even today in some places in India, people get together and listen and discuss Srimad Bhagavatam, Mahabharata, or Bhagavad Gita. And they do this always in the evening time with their friends, family members, and village associates. That was a regular affair to get together and discuss, read the scriptures together, and end the evening in that mood of hearing about the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So he went to the kingdom and they were discussing, and one pundit who was one of the chief ministers of the king was making an analysis of one particular point in the Bhagavatam. But Srinivas, he was just a guest there, he was listening, but he didn't like anything he heard. So he became a little disturbed. What are they speaking? And he started to indicate by his body language that this is wrong. So therefore the minister stepped back and says, well, you have a better understanding, let us hear your interpretation. And so he spoke, and when he spoke, everyone was amazed how he spoke and how clear he made the points. The word got back to the king, and the king was so happy, though he asked Srinivas, you stay here, and you become my chief minister, and I'll give you all luxuries and comforts. You just become my chief pundit here. And Srinivas did that. After some time being there, Srinivas said to the king, you know, when I came here, I was looking for some lost treasure. I'm traveling with the group of devotees, and we had a box of books, and now the books have been stolen. Can you help us find the books? He said, oh, I have the book. So he took Srinivas to the box and opened up the book. And there they were. And he returned them to Srinivas. But the most interesting thing was that when the books were packed, the Chaitanya Charitamrita was packed on the bottom. But when they opened the box, the Chaitanya Charitamrita is sitting on the top of all the other books. So we understand that when you place milk down in the container in a very settled place, gradually the cream will automatically come to the top without any efforts. So the cream of all the literature of Chaitanya Charitamrita, which Srila Prabhupada brought into our society as the main scripture to highlight the philosophy and the life of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. That book was now sitting on the top of all the other books. So Srinivas was amazed when he saw that, but he understood, yes, this is the best of all. So there are many wonderful stories in the life of Narottama. Narottama Das, as he gradually, he went to Vrindavan, met the devotees there. He went to Jagannath Puri and met the devotees there. And he came into Puri. All the devotees were so happy to see them. They stopped whatever they were doing and heard he was coming, and they greeted him with so many nice gifts and presents. And so he became a celebrity among the devotees because the word was out that a great personality is coming. And because of his reputation as being a great personality, he was welcomed in that way. And so as time went on, he started to preach. And now he was born in a Kayasta community, which the Kayastas are usually either Sudras or they're Kshatriyas. They're not Brahmins. Mm-hmm. And in those days, in order for one to become a spiritual master, they had to be a Brahmin. At least that was the mood of the society. Of course, the scriptures speak otherwise, that it's not by birth, but it is by qualification that one takes a particular post. So the birth was considered to be a lower birth, but still Narottama took the position of being a spiritual master. And many people were coming to him, even great Brahmins were coming to him. One such person was Narayan Chakravarti. And he was a Brahmin and a spiritual leader in his community, very much adored and glorified by the local people. But he took initiation from Narottama Das Thakura. When the word got out that he had taken initiation, there was an alarm. How can Narottama initiate someone who is in a higher caste than he is? But then again, we understand from the scriptures that it's not by birth, it's by qualification. And so he started to preach more and more. This caused some disturbance in the Brahmin community. And the Brahmins were becoming upset. Who is this person? Who thinks he can initiate Brahmins into Vaishnava philosophy? He's just bogus. And so after some time, they start complaining to the king in the area. His name was Nishinga Ram. And so they asked him, the king, can you, do something about this Narottama? He's ruining our whole process of devotion. He's ruining the whole culture. And so the king became a little concerned, so they made a plan that we should come. And they encouraged him, and we will bring one great pundit whose name was Rupa Kaviraj, and we will challenge this Narottama to a debate. Rupa Kaviraj will defeat him, and therefore. Then you can arrest him for being, falsely in the position of giving initiations, especially to people who are of the Brahminical caste. So the king went along, and so they traveled going towards Kapudra, where Narottama was staying. And now the word got out that the king, Kaviraj, and a group of Brahmins were coming to defeat Narottama. So two of Narottama Das's leading disciples, one was, of course, Narayan Chakravarti, and the other one was Ramachandra Kaviraj. They decided to foil the flight of the king. So they went ahead and set up a stand of betel nut and clay pots on the trail where the king would pass. And so the king and his entourage was coming, the Brahmins and Rupa Kaviraj. And so they said, oh, let's stop and get some betel and some clay pots. So they went up to talk to the betel and clay pot salesmen, who were both disciples of Narottama. And it was the most amazing thing happened is that they started speaking perfect Sanskrit to play the clay. But salesmen, the betel salesmen, were speaking not only Sanskrit, but perfect Sanskrit. And they were astonished. And they asked, well, who are you? Oh, we're disciples of Narottama Das Thakura. Oh, really? Yes, and if you want to go and debate him, you'll have to debate us first. So the word got back to Rupa Kaviraj, and then the king. And the king was amazed. He said, if the disciples of Narottama Das Thakura are such learned, imagine how great Narottama is. So I don't think we should go any further. So they turned around and left. So they foiled the plot to try to embarrass or to defeat Narottama. This is the duty of a disciple to protect his spiritual master when there is a necessity. Just like, if the spiritual master is somewhat being defeated or criticized. In front of his disciples, the leading disciples should step up and challenge the criticizer. That is the duty of the disciple. Spiritual master may not respond, but disciples must. So finally, the next day, And of course, after some time, of course, the most famous of all Narottamas that were passed on was the Kirtan Bhogas in Kesarita. And that was 50 years after the disappearance of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It was called the first Gaura Purnima Festival, where many of the followers who were relatives, friends, and associates of Lord Chaitanya's followers were still there, and they organized this Gaura Purnima Festival. And they decided to have it at the place where Narottama Das Thakura was born, his Janmastham. So the devotees from Vrindavan, the devotees from Jagannath Puri, the devotees from Navadvip, all came, headed by the most leading of all disciples at that time was Janabadevi. She was considered to be the guru of all of the disciples. And she was, of course, a consort of Lord Nityananda. She was the most revered and respected of all of the devotees. She also came. So Narottama was there, and there was a deity installation. They had organized six different sets of deities to get installed during this festival at the very beginning of the festival. There's one beautiful story how one of the deities actually was obtained by Narottama. There was this one merchant who had a godown. A godown is a storage area that's below the ground where people keep things. And the word was out that there was a deity of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in that godown. So when Narottama Das heard about that, he wanted to get that deity. So he approached the owner of the godown, the merchant, said, "Oh, you cannot go down there. There were many vicious snakes. And no one will even attempt to go down there. There's so many snakes in that godown." When Narottama Das, he rejected. And we went down, and the snakes didn't bother him at all. We went down the deity and brought it down. And that was one of the deities that was installed during that first day of the festival. So Narottama Das Thakura conducted the deity with installation. And later on, he led a kirtan. It was a beautiful kirtan, powerful kirtan, wherein he had started to. Very carefully, he got a pair of kartals, and very softly, with great attention, and very fixed devotion, started to sing the glories of the Lord. And we had an entourage of kirtaniers with him. There were 14 kartal players, and there were 7 mridanga players. It was a huge kirtan. But the kartal players and the mridanga players decided, began to kirtan very sweetly, very softly, with so much attention, so much devotion, completely fixed on the holy name. He started to chant, and gradually he started to pick up the speed. And as the speed started to pick up, then gradually the kartals started to chime in, and soon the mridangas followed nicely, and the kirtan started to take off. And Narottama Das remained this focused on chanting the glories of the Lord. Finally, after some time, kirtan reached heights of ecstasy. And at one point, when the ecstasy reached a certain level, the most amazing thing happened. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Lord Nityananda, Sri Advaita Gadadhara, Sri Vas, and many of the associates of Lord Chaitanya who had already disappeared from the planet after Lord Chaitanya disappeared, all of them, they all returned and started to participate in the kirtan. They weren't there in some dreamlike state or some imagination. They were there first and present, the very eternal mood of chanting and dancing. And as Narottama very carefully, with great love and devotion, started to sing, kirtans just started to go higher and higher. Devotees were dancing and crying, and the ecstasy was too much. Everyone was singing the Panchatattva. They had already left, and now they were back. And the ecstasy was just beyond anyone's ability to describe. This description is given some credence in the life of Narottama Das Thakura, written by Narahari Chakravarti, which is called Narottama Vilas. In that book, he very extensively, with great detail, describes this kirtan. And the devotees who were there, many of them saw their friends, their relatives, their associates who already had left the planet. They also reappeared with their family. Raghunanda Thakur saw his father Mukunda, and Chutananda saw his father Advaita Acharya. And so many of the devotees who had left that appeared in this kirtan. It wasn't a dream-like vision. They were personally present. And the kirtan was going on. And finally, at one point, the kirtan started to slow down and gradually Narottama Divasa. And then the kirtan actually started to stop. Everyone was really happy. So this describes a little bit about the life of Narottama. And I'll give a little brief ending here. Narottama Das Thakura's closest associates were Ramachandra Kaviraj and Srinivas Acharya. When Ramachandra Kaviraj left the planet, Srinivas Acharya was really in great lamentation and separation from him. But when Srinivas Acharya left, there was too much for Narottama to bear. The love between the great Vaishnavas cannot be explained. How dear they are to each other, because they are all very closely related in pure devotion to Krishna. And this is also a feature of devotional service. We as devotees, we develop relationships with each other based on our relationship with Krishna. And that relationship is just like friends and family members who are very close to each other. Because actually the spiritual family is the real family. We have our mundane family. Of course, if our mundane family are spiritual devotees, then it's spiritual family, awesome. But the real family is the spiritual family. And the love between the devotees becomes great just as much as that love for Krishna is patterned in their life. And so Narottama couldn't bear Srinivasa's disappearance. So he went into seclusion for about 2 weeks. No one saw him. Finally, they found him, brought him back. He stayed for a little while, but he decided this is too much, and he decided to leave. So one day, he just left his body. And then the devotees were very sad, but they wanted to go through with the disappearance ceremony. So they took his body and made an arrangement to have a program in honor of Narottama by glorifying Narottama just after his disappearance. His body was still there. So they laid his body out, and the devotees came, and people were speaking the glories of Narottama. But some of the envious brahmanas who didn't like what Narottama was doing, they also appeared. And they started to speak, not only speak, but speak loudly in bad language about who Narottama was and what he had done. and they were criticizing him, vilifying his good name. This was causing the devotees so much stress that couldn't be more inauspicious than when the great soul leaves the world, others are speaking badly of him. And so this was going on. So the great soul started pray to the Lord, my dear Lord, please do something. Performed a miracle. He was laying all of a sudden on his body a golden Brahmin thread appeared, shining. And then after that, he sat up and he came back to life. When the Brahmins, who were critical, saw that, they were repenting for him. So the Lord and the Lord's devotees started to apologize in so many different ways.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, dear devotees.
Okay, so now Narottama was back and he started to preach again. Still, his heart was so melted in separation from his dear Srinivasa. After staying with her a couple months, he decided to leave again. This time he called Narayan Chakravarti and he said, come with me. I want you to perform a service. So he led him down to the banks of the Ganges water. He said, oh, we will go into the Ganges water. And when we get up there waist deep, when you take Ganges water and you start pouring on my body, you bathe my body with Ganga water. And no matter what happens, don't stop. Don't stop. So as Narayan Chakravarti is picking up the water and pouring it on the body of Narottama, wherever that water touched, his body would melt and turn into milk. And the milk would flow into the Ganga. So gradually, as he was bathing, he was also crying because he was told, don't stop under the condition. And pretty soon, Narottama's whole body melted into the Ganges when it was done. It turned into milk. And that's how he disappeared. So we can understand how, what an amazing personality he was. And it's understood from the Shastras that in the spiritual world, Narottama Das Thakura's service is to cook milk for Radha and Krishna. He has that service of cooking nice, sweet tasting milk for Radha and Krishna every day in their evening pastimes. So here's a little bit about the life of Srila Narottama Das Thakura. Of course, for us, there are so many bhajans written by Narottama Das Thakura. So many amazing songs. Even the song that glorifies the disappearance of a great soul was written by Narottama. Aruna prachur heno kota kota gela charya taku. He would sing so sweetly and he composed so many beautiful bhajans, which are a repertoire of all of the wonderful bhajans written. Narottama Das Thakura is famous. Hari Hari Vipale Janamagonu Manusa Janamapaya Raha Krishna Navadi Janiya Sunya Pisaichu Golokira Premadana Harinam Shankirtan Rakim Jan Milokena Upai Dina Hina Chapta Chilo Harinama Udarilo Har Shakshi Jagai and Madai. Rajendra Nandana Yeri Sachi Sutta Hoylose Balaram Hoylo Nitai. The bhajans are famous. Narottama Das Thakura, and of course Bhaktivinoda Thakura fill our song book with numerous glorifications of the Acharyas and of the Supreme Lord with their beautiful songs. The one that we sing every day in the temple, the glorification of the spiritual master. Jiguru Charana Padmaham Kevala Bhakati Sadma Pandamui Savadharam Mate Hey Anharu Prasade Bhai Hey Bhavan Chori Hayane Krishna Prapti Hoi Anha Hoi Te Due to the glorification of Narottama Das Thakura's spiritual master, Lokanath Das Goswami, I didn't tell about his initiation, which is the really wonderful pastime, how he received initiation. He wanted to take initiation from Lokanath Das Goswami, but Lokanath Das Goswami did not want to take disciples. The nature of many of the great souls is that they don't feel themselves qualified to become a spiritual master. They would rather just do their bhajan and not take the position of being guru because they feel they are not qualified. But Lord Chaitanya inspired Narottama to take initiation from Lokanath. And Lokanath had refused. And so Narottama didn't know what to do. Every time he would approach his Lokanath, Lokanath would say, I'm sure you can find someone, but I am not your guru. And so, but Lokanath, every day, he would perform his morning duties and he would go out into the forest and take care of nature. So Narottama decided, well, I'm going to do some service for my spiritual master. And when Lokanath was finished, he would come and clean the area where Lokanath was. And then when Lokanath would come back to that same area, the next day, after some time, he was wondering, this area is very clean. Someone is coming to clean it, or who is that? So one day he decided to look and he hid. So after he apparently left, he hid behind a tree and he saw it was Narottama. When he saw that, he came out, he said, Narottama, what are you doing? You're a prince. You're doing this is not befitting your position as a prince. Narottama just all with folded hands, he said, there is nothing that gives me greater happiness than performing this service to my spiritual master. And Lokanath was thinking, he still wants to be my disciple. So, but he didn't say anything that night and went home. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared to Lokanath in the dream and said, give him initiation. So on the dream order of Lord Chaitanya, he accepted and took the position. That was the only disciple that Lokanath Swami ever had. So that song, Shri Guru Charana Padma, is the very last line, the very last stanza. How does that go? Lokanath Okira Jivana. Um, The spiritual master is the ocean of mercy, is the friend of the poor. And in that word, Lokeranjivan, he's saying, he's glorifying his spiritual master, Lokeranjivan Swami. So we sing that every day. And that is this beautiful bhajan in glorification. And Srila Prabhupada and many of the other acharyas also say that the songs of Narottama Das Thakura are pure scripture. They illustrate the pure devotion of the Vaishnava culture in the form of these beautiful songs. Narottama Das Thakura. So that particular song we sing every day, along with other beautiful bhajans by Narottama. There's a little bit about his life today. We can stop here and see if we've any comments or questions.
We'll just wait for a few seconds till Maharaj comes back. Thank you, Maharaj. Thank you so much for so nice narration of Narottama Das Thakura's life pastime. And so many of these pastimes I didn't know. So it was so nectarian to hear. He's starting from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu filling up the love of Godhead in a river. So that is Padma River. That was something very, very nice. And I hope that river still exists and we can go and have a dip in that river. Devotees, if you have any questions, comments, realization, if you, you know, it'd be really nice to talk about this, such a great and elevated Vaishnava. So please unmute yourself and keep your cameras on as well. And by the time Maharaj comes, you can think of the questions and think about them. And many of that, a list of the bhajans which Maharaj, you know, are talking about, I was also looking on internet. And there quite a few bhajans which Narottama Das Thakura, and I'm surprised to see that all of those bhajans which we love and we hear were written by, you know, Narottama Das Thakura mainly. I'm sure you have heard of Goranga Bolite Habe. That is a beautiful bhajan we all sing, and most of the bhajans like Agnidev Prabhu also sing, Maharaj sings. Ekaboro Karuna Koro, and then Goranga Karuna Koro. And then Hari Harai Nama was also written by, you know, Narottama Das Thakura. And then Jai Jai Krishna Chaitanya Nanda, Jai Anilo Prema Dhana, which Maharaj mentioned, Nitai Pad Kamala. Nitai Pad Kamala is very close to, you know, we all hear that bhajan so many times whenever we glorify Lord Nityananda. So Radha Krishna Prema Dhana, Prena Dhana. That is Shri Guru Charan Padma, Guru Maharaj mentioned. And so all these bhajans are so beautiful, and day in, day out, we, you know, we connect to the Vaishnavas, all this Nityananda, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Nityananda through this bhajans and through the emotions of Nityananda and Narottama Das Thakura. So please, it'll be nice to glorify and say something about Maharaj is busy cleaning up his table. So if you have questions, comments, please. And it would be nice to see you take your darshan as well. You can keep your cameras on. Thank you.
I'm here, so go ahead.
Yes. So devotees, yes, Maharaj can definitely hear. So Maharaj, by the time devotees are, okay, we have a question here. I'm just going to read this, Maharaj. This is from Ivana Mataji. Hare Krishna, Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glory Srila Prabhupada, all glory. Why did Narottama Das Thakur had to receive Krishna Prema through the river, even though he was such an exalted soul directly from the spiritual world?
You're questioning Mahaprabhu's methods? Mahaprabhu arranged that. That's not a question to ask. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he gave him his direct prema. Not just Krishna prema, his prema. Who asked that question?
Ivana Mataji, Ivana.
Oh, yes. You have Krishna prema in your heart too, but it has to come out. By the Lord's mercy, he makes it come out. Yeah, I think it's glorious how the Lord did that. That's just amazing how the Lord showed his special affection for this personality. And how it happened was even more amazing.
You're on mute, Ivana Mataji, if you're trying to say something. Thank you. She said, thank you.
I think it's glorious the way it happened. It illustrates Mahaprabhu's mercy.
Yes, Shridevi Mataji.
Thank you, Satyamama. Dear Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Guru Maharaj, I was thinking how amazing it is that Narottama Das Thakur is born a prince in a very exalted royal family with all opulences, with everything, and yet he had no interest in any material enjoyment whatsoever. This is indeed very remarkable given how difficult things are now in this day and age. For us to hear of these great personalities and understand the superiority of spiritual happiness over material enjoyment is something like an eye-opener and something to meditate on, that this person was so exalted materially also, but he had no interest in any kind of material enjoyment. I found that very remarkable.
Yeah, we have the same example with Raghunath Das Goswami. I mean, his parents were even richer. They were billionaires. And he was the only child. Prabhupada said, on the level of the income that they had, they would be considered billionaires nowadays. And he left everything. He didn't want anything to do with it. We can learn this how both rare and wonderful Krishna consciousness is. We have one of our sannyasis in our movement. When he, his father was a millionaire back in the 1970s, you know, which was, there weren't too many millionaires in those days. And about a year after he joined, his father didn't want him in Krishna consciousness. So he offered him $1 million if you leave the movement. And he refused. And then many years later, when this same devotee went to India, and he was helping Srila Prabhupada there, he was performing great austerities. He was helping build the Bombay Temple, which was the story of the Bombay Temple. It was amazing. And the struggle that Prabhupada had to go to build that temple. Prabhupada said, it was a great fight. There were so many people, big people against trying to stop that temple. And they had influence. They broke the temple after we got it partly built. They beat up the devotees. They put the devotees in jail. We had so many problems. And he was also there trying to manage. And he also went through a lot of difficulty. And then his father and mother, after some time, came to see him in India. And he was, because he was performing austerities, he was a little skinny. So his mother started crying when she saw him. No, you look so skinny, you're not eating properly. The whole mother was there. And then his father, again, this time he went right to Prabhupada and he met Prabhupada. And he said, you know, I'll give you $1 million. You just send my son back. Prabhupada said, you have to ask him. Prabhupada didn't say anything. He said, you have to ask him. And then, of course, again, he refused. So twice he was offered $1 million by his father. And you have to understand, during those days, $1 million is like $30 million today. The value of money has really changed drastically in the last 50 years. Yeah, so... And that was Giriraj Swami.
Oh, wow.
Yes, that's actually Guru Maharaj, these examples are so, you know, mind-boggling actually. How can we develop this taste for the higher, how can we develop this higher taste so that we are not pulled into the...
We know that there's nothing in this material world that can give you the satisfaction or even come close to that Krishna consciousness. The happiness in Krishna consciousness is compared to one drop of that happiness is compared to the happiness of liberation multiplied a million times. When we speak of material happiness, which is just a form of material suffering. So there have been many devotees, not on the same level as what I just described, have been offered so many opportunities for material success. Like when we were out on book distribution, sometimes people would say, hey, you know, here's my card if you need a job. You know, you're a great salesman. You know, so they would offer us nice jobs for being expert at selling books, you know. Well, the devotees would never take that. When Jamuna was there, and she met George Harrison, the famous George Harrison. George Harrison said, I can make you famous. And she told Prabhupada that. And Prabhupada didn't say anything. He left it up to her. And she rejected it. Because she had such a beautiful voice. She would have been one of the best singers in the secular world. But once you taste Krishna conscious, you think everything in this material world is like stool. Or it's different color stool. Brown stool, black stool, golden stool. golden stool is when you have that disease, what is that called? Hepatitis. Yellow stool. So gold is compared to stool of a person who has hepatitis. So a devotee, the taste of Krishna consciousness cannot be compared to any happiness in this material world. Because the happiness in the material world is just false. It's an idea. There's no real happiness there. It's just a false ego building itself up on this idea that I'm successful. Of course, if we get money, we'll use it for Krishna. If we get a chance to take big positions, we can take that and use it for Krishna. But the devotee will never trade Krishna consciousness for anything in this material world. A real devotee.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mataji.
What's his name? One king. He was the spiritual master of Ramanujacharya. Yamunacharya.
Yamunacharya,
yeah, Yamunacharya. He was a king. He gave it all up. And now he writes, when I think about, material happiness, my lips curl in disgust and they just spit. Yeah. It's like passing stool and then hanging around the stool thinking it's so nice. When Kolavetcha Sridhar was after he was favored by Lord Chaitanya, and Lord Chaitanya revealed himself who he was, he wanted to give Kolavetcha Sridhar anything he wanted. He said, my dear, Kolavetcha didn't have anything. He was hardly living from day to day. He was just taking some banana leaves and banana plates and selling it and using half of the money to live on the other half he would give to Mother Ganges. He didn't have even good clothes. And Lord Chaitanya revealed himself in the Mahaprakash Leela, where he's given document to many, including Kolavetcha. And he said, Kolavetcha, please take anything you want. I'll give you a nice wife, I'll give you riches on the same level as Indra in the heavenly planets. I'll give you an island, anything, even a planet. And Kolavetcha Sridhar, he was miserable. He said to the Lord, I'm happy. Why do you want to ruin my life? I'm happy. I don't want to mess up my life with all of these things.
Thank you, Maharaj. Namrita, you have a question?
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to Guru and Gauranga. Glories to Narottama Das Thakura. So, Guru Maharaj, I was once reading the article of Narottama Das Thakura on ISKCON Desire Tree, and I read that in the Kirtan party, when the deities were installed and Narottama Das Thakura performed a very ecstatic kirtan, all the panchtattva, they appeared along with the Mahaprabhu. So devotees there who were in the mood of Sakya Bhav, they saw Mahaprabhu in the Sakya Bhav, who saw who were in the Dasya Bhav, who were in the Vatsalya Bhav, they all saw it in that mood. So they also wrote that hundreds of devotees were in offering devotional service in this Aishwarya Bhav, in awe and reverence. So I was just wondering, I never saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in the Aishwarya Bhav. So how is that bhav? I was just wondering, how is that bhav possible with the because he is more with the Sakya Bhav, Dasya Bhav, and Madhurya Bhav.
Well, Aishwarya Bhav is Dasya Bhav.
Oh, okay.
It's a feature of Dasya. The mood of service.
So isn't that opulence, the mood of opulence?
Yeah. Well, just like we go on the altar, we dress Lord Chaitanya. We don't dress him as a sannyasi. We dress him just like we dress the rest of the deities, with beautiful garments and jewelry and crowns and like that. So we worship him in the mood of Aishwarya Bhav, and we do our deity worship in the temple. But as the individual devotee progresses, they start moving towards their relationship with the Lord, and then the Lord will appear to them according to that mood. But the deity is always worshipped in Aishwarya Bhav.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you for this clarification.
Even Radha and Krishna is worshipped in Aishwarya Bhav. Although Radha Krishna is Vrindavan, but there is no Aishwarya Bhav. But in deity worship, you can't approach the Lord on the mood of Madhurya or sweetness unless you are on that platform. And that's something that develops through the one's bhakti. But the deity is always worshipped in the mood of, Vishwarya. You give them nice jewelry, you give them nice clothes, helmets, earrings, bangles, all of this.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you for the clarification. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Namrata Mataji. Srimati Mataji?
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to Srila Narottama Das Thakura. Last year or before year 2020, I think in this same discussion, you mentioned about a book, Guru Maharaj, The Glorious Life of Srila Narottama Das Thakura. This is the book by Sheetala Dasi Mataji. So I bought that book at the time and I read it. It was so wonderful. Like I can't even express in my words like how glorious his life was and how much struggle he went through to come out of his mundane life and become a devotee. And because he was always attracted towards Lord Chaitanya and so in this Mataji, she wrote like as if it was happening in front of our eyes. When I was reading, I was into so much ecstasy. I still can't forget those. Still, it's in my heart, very nice, printed like that. And it's a very wonderful life of Srila Narottama Das Thakura and how he approached his spiritual master, how he did menial service to please him, to get his mercy. So wonderful, Guru Maharaj. I just want to share this, Guru Maharaj.
That book is glorified by everyone. And Sitala. Sitala is a Prabhupada disciple. She's the wife of Harisari. And I also read the book even before it was published. Someone had one of her friends had a manuscript, and that friend gave the manuscript to me and said, "We have to read this." And I said, "No problem."
Especially his parents, how they were struggling to bring him back because he was a prince, and they want him to be with them and take care of his their kingdom and everything. So that was so wonderfully written by Mataji. So I was very much
The life of the great souls is the inspiration we need and get in our devotion to serving. It's a direct inspiration in our own practice of Krishna bhakti.
It's good, Maharaj, yeah, definitely.
This is how we can understand how bhakti works.
And Guru Maharaj, I want to share one more good news and with your holiness and with all the God family. I'm very happy today. My mother got first initiation today from His Holiness Jayapataka Maharaj in India. And her name is Kanchanangi Vasudha Devi Dasi.
What's her name?
Kanchanangi Vasudha Devi Dasi.
Kanchanangi Vasudevi.
Vasudha Devi Dasi.
Vasudhari.
Vasudha.
Kanchanangi Vasudha Devi Dasi. She got her first initiation today. I'm super happy, Guru Maharaj. Please bless her and please pray for her.
Vasudhari Vasudha. Vasudha.
Yeah, Vasudha.
Oh, well, Vasudha is the other wife of Nityananda. And Kanchana means gold. Angi, Anda means limbs. Golden limb, Vasudha. And he describes the glories of Vasudha. Vasudha was the wife of Lord Nityananda, who gave birth to two children. One was Birbhadra Goswami, who was an incarnation of Shivadatta Vishnu. And the other one was Ganga Devi, who was an expansion of the Ganges River. Do you have a brother or sister?
Yes, Guru Maharaj, I have a sister. She's in India. She's also practicing Krishna consciousness. She just started recently.
So you just have just you and your sister? Right?
Yes, Guru Maharaj, yeah.
Well, that's pretty good, because Vasudha only had two children. So are you Shivadakshai Vishnu or expansion of the Ganges River?
My mom was waiting so long, Guru Maharaj. She read the whole Bhagavatam, and she read Bhagavad Gita twice or thrice, and she read all books, and she's waiting, and Maharaj gave mercifully today, the initiation today in Tirupati, and that too in the Kartik month. I was so super excited to listen, hear this.
It happened in Tirupati?
Yes, Guru Maharaj, yeah.
Oh, wow. At a temple in Tirupati?
Yes, Guru Maharaj. ISKCON temple is there in Tirupati, and there it happened, Guru Maharaj.
Oh, that's Panchatattva. That's
Ashtashakti. Yeah, Radha Krishna Ashtashakti. Just like in Mayapur, yeah.
What is the deity's name? Radha Govinda?
Yes, Radha Govinda.
Yes, Guru Maharaj, yeah.
I was there for the installation.
Oh.
I helped install Tanda Vidya. I did the Pada Pratishtha for Tanda Vidya.
Wow.
And that was in 2007 when I went to get done. Many of the pujaris and mahants from the Tirupati temple came And even the lead pundit came. And he conducted the whole puja, and he also spoke. And we were glorious. Yeah, that's I think the gravity Raman Prabhu is the
yes, yeah.
May amazing devotee. That temple is really big on book distribution. They have a warehouse that's bigger than the temple where they have keep all their books. They distribute books like crazy.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, congratulations. I didn't even know your mother was so advanced.
Yeah, it's all Srila Prabhupada's mercy and Jayapataka Maharaj's mercy.
Wow, wonderful. This is like the best part of my day.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Even mine too. I was so happy to hear this, waiting for her initiation. My dad is not that much into it. He just chants one round and he supports the temple. He pays donations and he does like that service, but he's not into all this philosophy and all, but he's still in demigod worship. But he chants one round.
Well, maybe some
Devotee
would like encourage him to catch up to his wife.
That's what I am trying, Guru Maharaj.
Maybe we have to say, the husband is supposed to be better than the wife. Come on.
Yeah. Competition.
Maybe has to make her father.
Guru Maharaj, Srimati is an amazing person. She is making all her family into devotees. Her nephew is chanting 16 rounds every day.
Yeah. We want to make the whole world Krishna conscious, but we have to get the family members too.
Yes, Guru Maharaj. Yeah.
Satyabhama, she made her husband Krishna conscious, and then she made her son Krishna conscious. Really?
You made them Krishna conscious, Guru Maharaj. It was nothing. It's all your mercy.
Well, I don't know about that. The husband really made a lot of, as soon as you became initiated, he came moving really fast, just up to the point just before the initiation. And the son, he likes the Krishna consciousness too. Yeah, it's our duty to work on the relatives. When I came to New Vrindavan, my sister, she came to see me. She had no idea why she was coming just to see me. And she went to New Vrindavan and she never left. She just came to see me. She got initiated a couple of years later, 1 year later. Ivana, you have to make your husband Krishna conscious. Pray for Ivana. She needs all the prayers she can get. Her husband is, he's on the other opposite end of Krishna consciousness. But somehow or other, he doesn't know it, but he's getting some benefit. And he's actually getting benefit by your own devotion. It's called jnata sukriti, unknowingly getting mercy.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Thank you, Hare Krishna. Thank you, dear devotees. Thank you so much. Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Thank you, Srimati Mataji. Such a good news. Congratulations.
I had two good things happen to me today. That was one of them. The other one is I got Jagannath Prasadam right from Jagannath's temple today.
You got nice prasadam, Guru Maharaj. Such a relief.
Huh?
I said, so thankful to hear you got nice prasadam. Such a relief.
I couldn't hear what she said.
Mataji is saying that you've got a nice prasadam, that is such a relief.
Yeah, I did. It was a spiritual relief, a spiritual upbeat.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much for that wonderful lecture. Hare Krishna.
Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks. And there was two news, Guru Maharaj, or you mentioned two or one? Is there one more?
No. The fact that I have Jagannath Prasadam and the fact that I through Matthew's mother took initiation, there was two wonderful things in my day.
Very bold. Thank you, Guru Maharaj.
Sorry. So I'm so happy I could share Hare Krishna.
It's good, Maharaj. As you were mentioning in the class, like we have mundane family and spiritual family. I am glad that my mother joined my spiritual family. So she's not, she's different now. My relation with her is different now.
That's really your mother. Are you still sick?
Who? Sorry?
Sridevi, are you still feeling
Sridevi? Oh, yes, Guru Maharaj. I'm sneezing and coughing now today, unfortunately. I thought it's going away, but now it's... Anyway, hopefully tomorrow I'll have one more day to take all the medicine and recover enough to cook for you on Sunday. I hope and pray. I don't want you to go without proper nourishment, Guru Maharaj.
Make sure you get enough rest.
Okay, I'll do that.
Rest is one of the best medicines.
Yeah, Mataji's medicines are very good.
Okay, I'm going to close the program because I just moved to a new place. I moved again. And no, I'm not in Rasamrita Kunja anymore.
I don't blame you, Guru Maharaj. I'm so thankful that hopefully you're in a better place.
I'm in Mayapur Institute now.
Oh, it is made very nicely with very good vastu.
Yeah, it's nice, and it's at least 2 kilometers closer than to the temple. That's the main thing.
Wonderful to know that you're in a very nice place.
Yeah, Rasamrita Kunja. When I got to Swargaloka, I didn't know what to do there. I couldn't find Indra, couldn't find any of the demigods. I just was looking around the room and I was thinking, where am I? Is this the lower planet, the hellish planets on the lower level? What is it called? The lower planetary hellish systems. It was really hell down there. I had this big room that was so big, I needed binoculars to see from one side to the other. I had 2 bathrooms, 2 bedrooms, a kitchen, 4 veranda, 3 bedrooms, everything. And I just thought, now I know what it's like in the heavenly planets, and I don't really want to go there.
Oh,
You're on your way to Swargaloka, aren't you?
No, Guru Maharaj, no.